start. If you judge a border purely from the linguistic point of view, you will be going against the wishes of many people. Invariably, there are bilingual areas. As long as you cannot prevent people of one state from going to another, there will always be bilingual areas. Are you going to stop, contrary to the dictates of the Constitution, the movement of workers or of other people from one state to another? You cannot. Therefore, whatever fixed line you may draw, people on one side may be attracted to the other and move there and thus change the linguistic composition of the state or of the border area. Are we going to sit down every few years and say the language ratio of this particular tehsil or taluk has changed and therefore it should be taken out of this state and put into another? You must realize that while there are clearly marked linguistic regions, there are also bilingual areas and even trilingual areas between two such regions. And wherever you may draw your line, you do justice to one group and injustice to another. From the language point of view, good reason, good logic, and good argument can be found for each side of every case. This is the difficulty. If there was logic only one side, we could decide easily, but there is logic on both sides and the two logics conflicts and the same to be balanced. You may balance them and say that one argument is stronger than the other. But generally, if the case of one side appears better, the case of the other side seems pretty good too. Maps and census figures have become the fashion now. Are we to weigh in a balance how many individuals speak one language and how many speak another? It will lead to all kinds of fantastic situations. I submit that we must consider this matter separately from the question of language. Of course, all the great languages of India which are mentioned in the Constitution have to be developed. I would go a step further and say that even those in the northeast frontier area and elsewhere ought to be developed. Further, the development of one language should not be and cannot be at the expense of the other. I am convinced that the development of any one of the great languages of India helps the development of the other languages. It is my privilege, however unworthy I might be, of being the president of the Sahitya Akademi, started a year or two ago, where we deal with all the languages of India and try to encourage them. The more we discuss these matters, the more we see that encouragement, development, and growth of one language result in advantage to the other Indian languages also. Going one more step, I would say that the knowledge of a foreign language helps the growth of an Indian language. If we are cut off from foreign languages, we are cut off from the ideas that are contained in those foreign languages and from technology, which is part of modern life. Therefore, let us not think of excluding a language. Quite frankly, I do not understand the way some people are afraid of the Urdu language. I am proud to speak Urdu and I hope to continue to speak Urdu. I just do not understand why in any state in India people should consider Urdu a foreign language or something which invades their own domain. Urdu is a language mentioned in our constitution. I object to any narrow-mindedness in regard to Urdu. It is no use dragging philosophy into these language controversies. Take the Punjabi language. We have heard learned arguments about the origin of Punjabi and the Gurumukhi script and how far it is connected with Hindi and so on, as if the source was of paramount significance. What matters is what people do today. Let scholars go into the past of Gurumukhi and Hindi. If people in the Punjab or elsewhere wish to use it, let them use. May I refer briefly to the question of the state's reorganization, which has been discussed here during the last 4 days. I have been greatly distressed about much that has happened. It has caused me much unhappiness and produced in me a sense of failure, which I do not often have. However, what has worried me and distressed me most is not so much the actual occurrences as the growth of a spirit of violence all over the country, or at any rate in parts of it. The attempt to settle problems by violent methods is, I think, very bad for this country, regardless of the merits of any cause. Once you enter the region of trying to settle problems by violent methods, you go towards something that is perilously near to civil war. Our country, with all its faults, has shown to the world a certain stability, certain peace, a certain measure of progress, and thereby established a certain reputation. This reputation is based on some fundamental characteristics. If we enter the region of violent explosions simply because dislike this thing or that, then we lose not only our reputation but something much more important than that. Are we going to become the type of country where every other month one hears of some kind of a violent revolution? That is not democracy, but something which is the very reverse of democracy. Apart from that, it is a complete denial of any idea of measured or ordered progress. I can understand an attitude, and I believe that some people hold that attitude, that nothing can be achieved by these slow democratic or parliamentary methods, that nothing can be achieved by peaceful methods, that in fact nothing can be achieved if one goes about it step by step, that one must break everything and produce some kind of a clean slate to start afresh on. Stop.